Sir, I know. How are you?
Okay.
So, I think last week we talked about this cluster, right? I hope you still remember what we have discussed. So, basically, we have a volume integral and then it's a surface integral, right? So, these two are related to each other. For this vector function A, if this A and also partial derivatives are continuous inside this region and also on the surface, right? And then you can see that the volume integral of the divergence of A and then this surface integral of A itself equal to each other, right? So the condition that N is the odd number and then S is the closed surface which is continuous right? So that's that basically the requirement. So if both exist, this means that they are equal to each other. So as we talk about a few examples, but we have not finished this one yet. There's another one or two examples, right? And this one we finished last week. Okay. So now you look at this one. Right, so if you look at this, we have this question has to verify Gauss's theorem for vector A, we can think about this one, right? And then, so for the region which is contained by closed surface, in this case, we have several faces because they are the test planes, right? So basically, it's a pentagon with vertices at 0, 0, B. So the sketch out is something like this one, right? So the way basically is a region inside this the pentagon, right? And then you have four vertices. So you have 1, 0, 0, and then 0, 2, 0, and then 0, 0, 3, and of course the one and the origin, right? So now you have four faces, right? In this case, right? So you have this one, that's one at the bottom, and then this one, and then you have another one, so ABC, right? So there are four faces. So this means that if you need to use, the question asks to verify. So verify means that you have to basically compute both this volume integral and also the surface integral and then prove that it's equal, right? So so that's why I'm not free my laptop not right. So anyway, I just use this notes to understand. So the surface for ABC is given by this. Look at the surface. If you need to find out the surface, right? What do you do then? Just see, in general, to find out the surface, you know, for the surface, just write down, Px plus Py plus Cz equals 0, right? And then just substitute this intersection, according to this intersection point in, and then you can be able to find out this which one surface? Which is sum of problem? The equation for this surface, for this ABC, this is given by this one, right? So we need this one to find out the normal vector to the surface, right? If you
on
what one? Because for any surface, remember you have ax plus by plus c back plus d for zero. So that's for any plane. This is the equation, right? So now just to substitute this this vertex into the other the one, and the intersection with that is 0, 0 axis. So it means that this zero is zero. So you get ax plus b. Which is zero, right? Sorry, this is the another thing. This 0, 0 t. So it means that c t plus d is zero, and then another one is 1, 0, 0, right? So 1, 0, 0 means that a x plus d is zero, and then last one, 0, 0, 2, 0. So 0, 2, 0 means that 2b, sorry. So 2b plus b, which is 0. So from here, you get that c, you can minus d or g. And then a, minus d. And then so now it's substitute in, you'll get minus d, minus dx, and then minus d over 2y, so minus d over 3z, plus d, 0. So d is common, right? So just cancel this out, so eventually you get x plus y over 2 plus d, sorry, that. That would be the one. Right? That's the that equation, right? So let's call it kind of the equation for the plane. It just this is just a general equation for the plane. You only know 3 points on the plane. The coordinate for 3 points, substitute in, and then can express A, B, C as function of E, right? And then after that, we substitute in and these cancel out. Right? And then you get this. So that's for all the equations of the plane, this one. once you know this, so now the normal to this plane is a gradient, right? So this a gradient of this equation for the plane, and then you find out this is I plus j over 2 plus k over 3, right? And then of course the unit norm is just normalize this one, then you get this one, right? Just normalize it, okay? And then you find the equation for the so once you know this, you know this equation for this line. So equation for this line basically is z equals 0, right? So equation for the line, which is the intersection between this plane and the xy plane, means z equals 0. So you get x plus y over 2 to 1, right? So that's this equation for this line. So x plus y over 2. So now we try to calculate the surface integral on the four faces. So the first one is A over B. So you go back to A over B, you see that A over B, basically this plane, right? A over B. And then the orthonormal of this plane is minus J. Because this plane is on the XZ plane, right? That's why orthonormal is minus J, right? So, to answer this, you see, just in the calculate this A dot N, A of course is given by the question, right? Look at this B. So, A is given by this, right? So, that's why A dot N minus G. So, A dot minus G, and then this is 0, you get the minus 2y, right? Of course, it's 0. Y for that plane is 0. So you look at the y. So y for this plane. So this plane, the equation of this plane, y is 0, right? Because this is in the x and z plane, so it's y equals 0. So that's why eventually n dot a for that plane. So you get a minus b, right? It's minus almost b. Because it's an orthonormal. So the box, you look at this one. See, this is the three-dimensional region. It's three-dimensional region is a pentagon, right? So the orthonormal of this closed surface, you have four faces. So the orthonormal for this one must be pointing towards this direction, right? So if it's in this direction, it's the internormal. Because it's for this surface, this is, right? So that's why the orthonormal must be in this direction, right? So if it's G, it means internormal. Right? You can tell this. No? It's just like, see, if this is this region, this is the enclosed region, you have this surface, right? So for this surface, this is the orthonormal. And if in this direction, it's the internormal because you're pointing towards inside of this region, right? So, and then the orthonormal for this one is fine, right? And the orthonormal for this one is this one. And the orthonormal for this one. Right? So that's how you choose it. Okay. So the answer is your A, and I just said y is 0, right? So that's why there's no y here. Because your y, the equation for this plane is y for 0. And that's why the y term is done. And then you plot this one with this one, of course you get 0 because you don't have I, K here, but here's G, right? So that's why eventually you get 0. Okay. And then similarly for AOC, is what happens. Okay. So the AOC is this surface, AOC. The equation for this plane, this is x equals 0, all right? Because so this is the plane on YZ plane. So that's the back surface, right? That's why the equation for this plane is the x equals 0, right? So, and then the orthonormal for this back surface, AOC, is a negative x direction, is a minus I, right? So that's why when x is 0, so the x is 0, so for A, you have a 2yj plus 6zk, and dot is minus I, so A you get 0, right? Because there's no I here, right? You get 0. And so next one is COB. So COB, COB, C, OB is the bottom plane. So for this bottom phase, orthonormal is pointing downwards, right? Because it is in this direction, it's pointing upwards. This means that it is inner. So that's why the orthonormal for this phase is minus k, right? And then the equation for this plane is that for zero. So that's why you have and that equals zero. That's why there's no z here. Alright, and then minus k. So again, the dot product is zero. Alright, that's why the surface integral for AOB, AOC, COB are all zero. So the only one left is the ABC, right? The ABC. So your ABC basically is this standard length, right? This one. So A, B, C. So for this one, right? So we just need to integrate on this plane. So now, still remember, right? It just projects down to the xy plane, and then so you have a dot n. So n is the one we just calculated, right? So it's a normal is a unit normal, orthonormal to this triangle, right? And then ds is 1 over n dot k, remember, right? So 1 over n dot k, ds dy. So 1 over n dot k is basically is this one, right? Just flip over, okay? So, this one, and then n dot k. So basically, this one multiplied by this one, right? And then you flip over, so that's why you get 7 over 2, right? Dx dy. And then after the integrate for this one on x, y, plane. So after the just integrate this one on the space. Right, because when you project this one down to x by 10, is what you get, right? So this does it. And then you integrate this one. So the equation for this line already given. It's x plus y over 2 to 1, right? So that's why. So if you integrate for x first, right? Integrate for x first, and then you just need to substitute the y by the equation of the there's no let me see. This z must be replaced by equation of the plane. That's the triangle, so you just substitute in. And then you get a function of the x, y only, so there's no z, right? And then you integrate for x first, and then you need to find the lower and the upper limit for x. So the lower limit in this case, the lower limit for this case, I hope you follow me. So in that base, if we recall this one, this is the x and this is the y, right? And the equation for this one is this is a line, right? So this is the 1, 0, and this is the 0, 2, right? So that's why the equation for this line is by x plus y over 2 with y, right? Right, so this is this line, right? It's x plus y over 2 with 1. The one we just found out, this one, right? So we just looked at this, right? So now you integrate this. So this is your r, right? So get the log, if you integrate, so I will not write down this function here, which is x, y, function x, y. So dx, dy. So you integrate for x first. So you see now, this is the x, right? So x is from this line. So this is x equals 0. So the upper limit for x is this one, right? Right, so it's up. So that's why given by, so just from here, so x over 5 minus y over 2, so just from here. And I'm left for y, so y is from 0, it's like 0, right, to this point, so this is 2, right, so it's good. So you just integrate this, and then you get level, right, that's so I'm not integrate this, this is what you just integrate, you should get the 11, okay, so 6 minus the okay, so basically you do it 3 times 6 minus 3x plus the y, so making it the 11, right? So that's the surface integral. So you have 4 faces, but the surface integral on the other 3 faces are 0. So that's why the only one which this might be not 0. This means that the surface integral on the closed surface is 11, right? So this is for surface integral. But in the white part, Gauss's theorem, this means that you have to calculate this volume integral. This is the divergence of A integrated over the entire volume, right? So now we try to find out divergence of A. Since A is a very simple function, so divergence of A is 11. Right? So this is x constant, y constant, z constant, right? It's 11. This means that eventually this volume integral is given by 11 dV, just integrate, right? So now, so basically it's 11 multiplied by the volume of the tetrahedral. And the volume of the tetrahedral, you learn this in geometry, right? It's a 1 over 3 times this tree is the height, and then multiply by the area of the base. So 1 over 2 times 1 over 3, eventually you find out this is 1 and 11, right? So if you don't know how to, if you don't know how to capture this one, we still can integrate this, alright? So get volume. So basically, attack here, this so this is 1, 0, 0. So this is 0, 2, 0. And this is 0, 0, 8, right? So how to calculate the volume of this one? Just to integrate. So integrate this one. And basically, it's a dv. Dv is the dx divided by dv. We integrate for z first. Then dx and then dy. Right. So for z, what's your lower limit? Lower limit is the bottom, the base. Right? That's why you get 0. And the upper is this one. So this equation given by x plus y over 2 plus z over 3 plus 1. So this means that z is given by 3 times y minus x minus y. So that basically is the upper limit 3, 1 minus x and y over 2. That's the upper limit, right? And then we just integrate this one first, and then after that we can integrate down the x by the plane. So integrate this first, so we get this is the top integral, we're not done yet, right? So this is the r, this is here, right? We're not done yet. So now z, since it's just z, right? You integrate. Basically, z, lower limit, and then upper limit, right? So, and then you have dx dy, and then, so your r is still here, so this is z, right? So eventually you have 3 times y minus x, y over 2, and then dx dy, right? So now, you integrate for the, so just now, when you integrate for y, remember, this is 0, sorry, for x, and this is 0, so what is 1? This is 1 minus y over 2, right? Then dx, dy, so y from 0 to 2. Okay. Now you integrate g, 0, 2. So, integrate for x, for this one. So integrate for x first, right? So now, and for x, you have x minus 1 over 2, x squared minus what is 1? And integrate for x is yx 2, right? And then you substitute in 0, 1 minus y over 2. So after that, you just integrate for y. Because after you substitute this one, you put it right here, you only get 5 and then integrate. Anyway, you should get 11. So after that, I will show you this just subsequently. Right? So this means that if you cannot memorize how to find the volume of the table, and then you have to integrate. That's why you can sometimes do limited data. So basically, this verify that Gauss serve indeed goes for this case. So the next example is again we have this vector function A. We need to evaluate this surface integral by means of a Gauss theorem. So here S is a closed cylinder bounded by the two surface, means it's the bottom of the top surface. So this means that this S itself is a closed surface. So it contains the sketch of this is like that. So it's a cylinder, part of a cylinder, plus the top and the bottom surface. So this means that the whole thing is closed, right? So in order to find the surface integral on this closed surface, by using Gauss theorem. So this means that you don't need to evaluate this one directly. So you only need to evaluate the volume integral of the delta of A, right? So that is the question. So delta of A, since A is given, just find out what's the delta of A, the divergence of A. So you should have Z plus 2X minus 2, right? That basically is the delta of A. And then integrate the on the volume is you have dy, dx, dz, right? So, okay. So in this case, conversely, this is, you have a cylindrical, you have a cylinder, right? So that's why it's good to change it to a cylindrical system, right? It's easy. So obviously, you can do it to integrate for z first, right? So, maybe you just, from the bottom to the top of the cylinder. So that's why it's from a 0 to 3, right? So that's why it's from 0 to 3. And so if you integrate, then of course you get a double integral, right? Because z is already integrated. So you have 1 over z squared plus 3x minus 2, and then from 0 to 3, and then ex dy, right? So yes, integrate wise. Something is tricky. So you have a z, z, z. This is 2 z. Z here. That's why the subject is 0 in. Anyway, which is 0 to the other. After this one. So you have 3, 9, right? So 9 over 2 plus 9 x. And minus 6, right? And then dx dy. That's what happens. Okay, so now remember what's the R. R is the surface region after you project this whole thing down to the x y plane, right? And so this surface region has the values of y because the cylinder is given by x squared by y squared is y, right? So that's why, since you have this kind of a surface symmetry. So it's always good to change this one into a holographic system. So you have R cosine theta, and the Y is R sine theta. Right? Please remember G, right? So for this case, G is given by R from X, Y, and polar. So that's why I'm writing it. So when you have dx dy by R, dr is theta. Right, this is what the polar point is. I hope you can remember this one. If you cannot remember this one, you can take it as a check hole. size of m by r of x, y, and policy, right? So if you accept this, so now you write down, okay, you have nine plus two minus six, the constant, right? Just together. So you have this is minus three or two, right? Plus 9x, so 9x is this one. So 9r cosine theta. Then you have r, and then dr d theta, right? So for polyhedral system, if you have a cylindrical region, and then the origin of the cylindrical region is at the center of this cylindrical region, is the origin of the polyhedral system, and then it's always from 0 to the radius. That's why r of 0 to 1, so 1 to the radius. And the theta of course is circular, right? So the center is not shifting. That's why you can be from 0 to 1. Right? And then that we okay. When you have this kind of integral, I always suppose that you try to look at the symmetry first. And then you decide which one you should integrate. Because this one, if you integrate for theta, automatically get zero. That cause that this constant theta from 0 to 2 pi is integrated. Right? So that's why just avoid it. Okay, can you understand this?
The r is 0 to 1.
R 0 to 1 because the base, the cylinder given by x squared plus y squared is 1. That's 1. At the cylinder. Then you project the cylinder down to x, y, plane, you get this circular region. So the radius of this is 1. Right? That's the this is given by x squared plus y squared is 1. Okay. So this is your r. This is after you project your cylindrical region, it's a solid. Down to x, then you get this kind of
thing.
What is 0 to 2 pi? 0 to 2 pi is for cylindrical, remember, for polar body system. So this x, y, you have a circular region with a center circular region, at the origin of your x, y coordinate system. And then theta is always from 0 to 2 pi. Because this is theta equals 0. Because if you are here, this is your theta. So, you see, in order to get this circular region, you just go to this one here, right? Sweep this one for what? 360 degrees. You get this circular region, right? Right? Is it okay? Is it okay, right? Yeah, that will help. Right. So, how did you get this circular region? If this is a cylinder, this is a cylinder, right? You just project this one down to x y plane. See what you get. You get a circular region, right? Circle, right? Right. There's a region bounded by the circle, right? The circular region. Okay, that's what you have. So anyway, so this one, once you see this, I suggest that you integrate the theta first. You know why? Because when you integrate the theta, this one is zero, then you don't care about the integration of r. If you do an r first, after that, you integrate the theta. So it's an extra step, which is not necessary. Right? So that's why just integrate the theta first, so this one is done. You can just ignore this one. Because you integrate this one for theta, so you do it for theta first, right? It's 0 to 1. And so you only integrate this one. And so you have d theta the r. Right? So now it's very easy to integrate, right? So if you integrate this one for theta, just get 5, right? So minus 3 or 2 or 5. have two type of pool. Right? So this is what you have. So but in the last videos, you can see that I include for S5 first, after the step bandwidth, you can always put the step first. Right? So you put screen home. So that's this one. Okay. Next, we have a last very important theorem, actually it's two, but we start from Stokes theorem first, because we don't prove it, that's why we don't need the Green's theorem to prove Stokes theorem, but we use Stokes theorem to derive Green's theorem. That's why we look at the Stokes theorem first. The Stokes theorem is given by this. Okay. So now, equal to the line integral, not the circle here, because this is boundaries of the closed. So it's just equal to the line integral of this A along this boundary. This is called Stokes theorem, right? So this means that the Gauss theorem will relate to this wall integral of the divergence of A to the surface integral of A. But Stokes theorem will relate the line integral of A to the surface integral of the curve of A, right? So we have a divergence of the curve, right? So that's a very important theorem and also very useful. So from this, what we can understand that we can understand the meaning of curve. And from this, remember, we understand the meaning of, you still remember this one, right? So from this, last week, we find out that the divergence of A is given by the limit when this is delta V equal to zero, and then the surface integral is called flux, right? Total flux across this one for unit volume, and then that. Right? This is what we derive. It means if you have this Gauss theorem and then you try to think and understand, you know, what's the meaning of that word in A, right? And similar for this one, is by now imagine that this boundary becomes smaller and smaller. Anyway, it becomes very small. But inside, we always have a point we call P. So now imagine that you just make this surface as small as possible. But no matter how small it is, at least contains point P. Okay? So we do this, and then we just call this into delta S. Okay? Now, and then, since this is very, very small, and then this integration is just the average, so eventually you get del cross A and dot N. You take the average of this one within this small circuit area, and then multiply this integration multiplied by the surface error that they have, right? And this, of course, is equal to this line integral, right? So now, if we let this delta S approach zero, and of course, this average value become the value of delta cross A of N at point P, right? This means that so delta cross A is a vector dot with N at point P. So at the point P, basically just one way, right? P is an arbitrary anyway, right? And then this is given by, so delta S equals zero, given by this line integral along this boundary divided by delta S, right? So what this, so basically you can see that it's a delta cross A itself is a vector. And then this vector, at this point, the vector itself, delta cross A, might be just this one. Direction is here. Right? That's delta cross A. That's the curve of the vector field. The vector is defined inside this region, right? So this means at any point you should have a delta cross A. And then delta cross A dot N means that you project this one down to this plane. This is talking about the path. So of course this is a standard, right? It's a constant of delta cross A along the n direction. It's equal to this one for a unit area. So this is called circulation of vector A. So it means that it's a circulation of vector A for a surface area. It is the projection of delta cross A in the normal direction of this surface, right? So this means that very different understanding. So this means that the delta cross A somehow is related to the circulation of this vector around this point. So if the vector is circulating very, very fast, and then this delta cross A will be large, right? But this circulation itself is along a certain axis. So that axis is delta cross A. It is the circulation itself is across. Around this axis. But this axis itself is not in the normal direction of the surface. The normal direction of the surface is here, right? But the projection of this one on this normal surface is the circulation of the vector along this
boundary for unit subcategory.
Can you understand? If this is a surface, right? The normal direction of the surface is just like this, right? But the curve of this vector A at this point is this direction. So this means that your vector self is something like this, because this is the direction. So this is something like this, right? But your surface is this one, right? So the normal direction surface is here, right? So that's why if this tool, if you choose the surface such that it's in this direction, then you do that, right? So this is a normal direction of the surface. And then the curve of this vector is this direction. This means that this vector is just something like this, right? So how fast is surface is given by the magnitude of this. And then along which axis is surface is given by the direction of the curve, right? But the surface can also be chosen in all different directions, right? Like this, right? Or this. So this means that by this one will not change, right? So in this case, when you integrate this one, you integrate along this, right? So that's why you have to project this one here. And then this projection is equal to this thing, right? But if that's sick, and then possible input projection. Can you satisfy? This means that the vector itself is circulating in space, but you can choose any arbitrary surface such that this surface will contain this point, right? And then once you do that, from the line integral of A along this curve, if we were to find out that the projection is one in direction. But when you choose such that this known direction is exact same as this direction, and then the line integral along this curve divided by the surface error is exactly the magnitude. So, I hope you can answer this. Something kind of realize, right? So this is just tell you how fast the vector is circulating. Right? Okay, as a meaning. Now we will not prove this again. It's not very difficult, but problem that we don't have time. That's why we just skip this. But once you have this one, now we can go back to this Green theorem. So Green theorem is just a special case. So the Green theorem is because if you want to prove Stokes theorem, we need to learn Green theorem first. But we don't prove, and then just do this one. The Green theorem is a special case of a Stokes theorem. Okay, so let's show you. Now, the Green theorem means that so this x y plane. This surface is on the x y plane. Okay? So see, this is the boundary of L, and then this is the S, right? So in this case, then again you write down your Stokes theorem. The Stokes theorem, remember, given by this, right? L cross A dot n t s. Right, so this is equal to this line integral along this boundary, right? So basically, it is given by A dot the dr, right? So now, we can check the del cross B because now this S is on x y plane, so that's why your del cross A is given by I. K and K, right? So we have a partial partial x, partial y, and then partial partial z. So ax, by, and then dz, right? So that's why eventually, so you have a this is your s constant, right? For example, y, and then minus y. And then example, that's the x component. So your y component is vector bx and vector z minus vector bz and vector x. Right, and then z component, so the z component is given by vector ay and then vector x minus vector ax vector y. That's your curve, right? Now, in this case, your n, if we choose this one, your n basically is k. Right? Why? Because S is a plane on the xy plane. So this means that the normal to this one is k, right? It's k. So if it's k, so that across a dot n, you only get this one. You only have z component, right? So that's why. So this becomes. And then remember S in this case, when you project down to xy, this is R itself. So in this case, S and R are the same, right? So you just want to put R in. So, and then you have this vector a, y, vector x, right, and then minus vector b, x, vector y, and then dx, dy. Right, because this x project down to x y plane is the same as dx, dy because it's on the x y plane, right? So, and then it's given by this one. A, so basically AX, BX, plus BY, BY, because Z is zero, right? And it's the correct here, so the coordinate. Okay. So this basically is your Green's zero. Okay, look at this one. Your right hand side basically is this one. Because you see AY is the xy are continuous, have the continuous first order. Yeah, so your p, the q, you can see that what's your q? Your q is your ay, right? Q is ay, and then p is ax. Q is ay, and p is ax, right? And then you have p here, and then the q, right? So that's exactly that one. The that all you have to prove. So basically, this Green's theorem is just a special case of Stokes' theorem, right? Then you get this. So, of course, in Green's theorem, we didn't mention about the vector function, but basically, it's just like this, right? So, your anyway, we can specify B, right? So, A, B, Y, A, X are arbitrary. This means that you just take an A, Y as a function of X, Y, and P as A, Y as a function of X, Y as well. One is Q, the other P. Right? So exactly the same. So now, so again, we'll prove this. Now we just look at this one example. This is by Green's theorem. And if you need to evaluate this one, so L is the boundary of this surface region, so X square plus Y square root 1. And then, so basically, one is P and one is Q, right? So P is to P and this is Q. Right, and then you don't need to do this line integral, just need to evaluate this this double integral. So this will be Q, this is this one, and then this will be P, that one, and then just different this one is vector X, this one is vector Y. So you need to get this is 2 minus 1 and dx dy. So 2 minus 1 is 1. So dx dy for that subset region, this is the area of the subset region, right? So and then radius is 1, you get pi r squared, r is 1. It means it's very straightforward, right? If you want to integrate the line integral and also one, I think it takes a bit more time to do that compared to this one, right? So that's what I can add. And then look at the examples of Stokes' theorem. Okay, example of Stokes' theorem. So in this one, we have one example. we need to find the, okay, if the question asks you to use a stop term to evaluate the, this line integral along a closed curve, so what this means? It means that you don't need to, you should not evaluate the line integral. You have to integrate the surface integral, right, on the surface bounded by this curve, right? If the question asks you to verify, this means that you have to do both. You have to evaluate both the line integral and also the surface integral, right? That's why in this question, so the question asks you to evaluate, use Stokes term to evaluate this. This means that you should not evaluate this one directly, and then you have to evaluate the surface integral, right? On the surface, which is bounded by this boundary L, right? If the question asks to verify Stokes theorem, this means that you have to evaluate this one and also the surface integral and show that you are evaluating that. Right? That's the difference. Okay, so now, so basically, we don't evaluate this line integral along this closed curve, but we evaluate the surface integral, right? So this surface is driven by, okay, sorry, this is the question. Part of the question is missing. So actually, because we talk about giving the surface itself. Anyway, the surface is given by this one. It's the example 4.3, right? Yeah, okay. So I think somehow the question, the second half of the question is missing. So I should define the L. So L basically is the boundary of this triangle ABC. So this triangle ABC is about this one. Sorry, forgot about this. Okay, but anyway, so here I already give you this equation of the plane now on this triangle, which is given by this one. Okay, so this means that so your left angle was, can you put okay, put this one, so this is the x, this is the y, this is that. So from this one, you see that when x is 0, y is 0, and z is 2, and then so x intersects 1, this is 1. So in your figure 4.23, you can put this one as 1, 0, 0, and this one is 0, 1, 0, and then this is 0, 0, 2. So this is the case, and this is given by z divided by 2 plus x plus y 1. Right? Can you just put this coordinates on the figure? The BC in the figure. 4.23. 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. But otherwise you cannot come out. You cannot come out this equation from there, right? So you must have that coordinate first. Once you have this, and then you find the so-called normal, unit normal. So unit normal just find the del, this gradient of this equation of the plane divided by this magnitude, right? So this comes from here, del this one. And then you get this one. That's a normal to this plane, normal to this plane, unit normal, right? And then del cross m, and then because we can find out the surface integral by using Stokes theorem, right? So this means that to do the surface integral for del cross m instead of m itself, right? So that's why del cross m, so we can try to find out that is given by this one. Okay? And then del cross m dot n, so n given. And then ds, remember, so when you project down this one, ds is always given by dx dy divided by n dot k, right? So this is we learned this for the surface integral, right? So that's very good. But in this case, somehow, if you want to skip it by using your geometry knowledge, and then you can always do that. But this is del cross m dot n, del cross m dot n is given by this. Just a number. In this case, somehow it's just a number. So if this number, you just take it out and then you integrate this ds on ABC, so this means that you get the area of BC, right? So the area of BC want, you can use your geometry knowledge to find out. Right? Because you know the length of the three sides. And so basically, the area of this one, right? And if you, you want to use the geometry knowledge to find out this one, you can do that, right? So basically, this one multiplied by this one, divided by, right, this one. If you feel that this is difficult, you cannot find out this one, just do integration. Then this means that just do integration, and then you just integrate for x and y, right? So maybe just do it for you. Okay. If you don't know how to do this, and then this integral given by 8 over 3 dx dy. Right, you just do it for dx dy. Let me see. And then remember dx, right? The project is like down to the xy plane. So your dx is dx dy divided by n dot k. Multiplied by n dot k. So divided by n dot k. So n dot k is 1 over 3. Maybe over. That's why it's another 3 here. Then this becomes r. So this is r. Right? So n dot k, right? So, and then this chain, cancel out. You have 8 dx dy. And this is r. So, now you can use your geometry knowledge to do that, right? You don't need to integrate, right? Because now R is this space. And then this is a rectangle, right? So that's why I have an 8 times 1 over 2, 1 times 1, right? So basically, it's this one times this one divided by 2, because this is a rectangle, right? That's why I have 4. You see that one. So this means that if you find the area of ABC, ABC is a slanted triangle, right? Just take a look. And then you just project it down since you already have n, just u n dot k, you project this ABC down to xy plane, and then you just need to find the area of this one. It's much easier, right? And that is equal. Is it okay? Okay. If you don't need to integrate for x, y, and z. You can do that by the way. You take a few minutes. Oh, that should come on. Which one? This one?
Yeah.
This is because you're just ds. So ds is by dx dy n dot k. So your n dot k is 1 over 3 because your k, you see, n is for k, right? It's 1 over 3. Right? So you get that dx dy 1 over 3. So this is k. Because ds is a subscalar on this plane. Dxy is here, so dxdy. Ds is all larger than dxdy, right? But a factor of n dot k, right? So this is what the point we get in this rule. So next one, so the question says that this question, they didn't tell you whether you should use Stokes rule or not, right? You see, it said if f equals this, evaluate this surface integral, f given by this, evaluate this surface integral, where s is part of this surface. So this surface, this is a harmonic surface, right? For which z is smaller than 1 over 2. So once you have this kind of question, you should immediately think that maybe the question is suggesting that you should use Stokes theorem, because if not for Stokes theorem, normally you just integrate for f instead of for del cross y, for del cross f, right? But if you don't want to do that, you still want to search the integral, and then you can find out the integral, it's the same. But you take more time to do that. So that's why, for this case, obvious that we should use Stokes theorem to find the line integral on the boundary of this. So the boundary of this is given by this. So S itself is given by this harmonic surface. And then the boundary of this is this one. It's only open boundary, right? The surface. So that's why instead of integrate the Delphos F on this entire hollow surface, we just need to integrate a line integral along this boundary, right? So now, okay, basically this question tells you exactly how you should choose the internet and then this orientation of the curve, right? So to do that, you try to find out n first. So anyway, in this example, actually, I show you two different ways to do that, right? But so now, if you just look at this Stokes curve first. So and to do that, you find out n, and so this is n. N for the n for this surface, because the equation of surface given, we just define the del this given by this one. Z equals 2 x squared plus y squared. That's why n of the surface is given by this. Del z minus this one, right? Just bring the right hand side to the left hand side for the equation of the surface, and then divide the magnitude of this one. So if you do this, and then eventually you end up like this. So now from here you know you should, this is a very important step. So once you get the n for the surface, you should judge from here. So whether n is pointing upward or downward. Because here z is positive. So this means that your n basically is given by this. See, your n is this one. At this point, your n is this one. And then of course at this bottom point your n is this one, right? And then at this point your n is this one. So that's why no matter where you are, your n always has a positive decomp. However, if the n is pointing down, if the n pointing down like this, your z component is negative, right? Just this is your z axis, right? You forget this one, this direction, forget this one to z, get negative component. So that's why from the mathematical expression of n your object, you should be able to draw this normal direction on this surface. Right? This is important because without drawing this one, you cannot determine this orientation for line integral. So if this orientation is indicated wrongly, and then your line integral will get negative value. Right? So that's why now you can see that follow the rule, right? Right-handed rule. So this is a boundary, and then this is a known direction, right? Or you work on this boundary, okay? With the surface S always at your left-hand side. Just imagine that if you work on this one, see the surface always at the left-hand side, right? And then your head is pointing to the direction, right? So this is one other way to do that. So, so this means once you know this, so why is this orientation important? It's because you do this line integral, you project this down to x y plane. If you go this way, the theta will increase from 0 to 2pi. If you go the other way, the theta from 0 to minus pi to 2pi, or from 2pi to 0. It's just opposite, right? So if you answer this, now, okay, we use second method because the question didn't ask you to go both, right? So if you use the Stokes theorem, is what you have. So this surface integral is given by the line integral of f. Remember, the surface integral is for del cross f, but the line integral is for f itself, right? So now, for f, it's very straightforward. Why? Because z is a constant. So because your dl, you have dx, dy, dz, but dz is zero because z is constant. That's why you only have dx, dy, right? So, because f is a, look at f, basically you. So f is given by this one. F is this one, so that's why you have y dx, f dot dr is y dx minus x dy, but dz is zero because z is constant on the boundary, right? So why is that constant? Because you integrate along this curve, z is constant, right? So that's why dz is zero, then you have dx, dy, and then you integrate for theta. Again, in this case, just change to a polytoid system, right? So z is 1 over 2, that constant. And then you use a parenthesis theorem. So your y is q, y is p, and then and minus x is your q, right? So, and then you use the Stokes theorem. You go back to the Stokes theorem. Parenthesis theorem. The parenthesis theorem basically is that this volume integral for this q divided by x minus p given by y, and this px dy is given by this line integral, right? P dx plus q dy. This is the parenthesis theorem we just learned. So that's why I can substitute this in. So now in this case p is y and q is minus x, right? So q is minus x, differentiate minus x, and x get minus 1, and then p differentiate y get 1. So minus 1 minus 1 get minus 2. That's why it's minus 2 tx dy, and tx dy is the area of the circular region, right? Because the radius is 1 over 2, so just calculate then you can apply over 2. That's why Stokes theorem. You can see the inverse report very easy, right? So if you do surface integral, this is what you can do. You already found out del cross f. So you had found out del cross f, right? Because the integration is called del cross f. So it's actually get zi minus 2k. Okay? And then this one, dot with your n. So n basically here, right? Dot with n. And then eventually you get this. Dx is dx dy. Dx is dx dy multiplied by this one. Right? And then of course this one you can cancel with this one. That's why you eventually get minus 4xd plus 2 dx dy, but already project down the R plane. And then you don't have xy, you don't have that anymore, right? So again, R is the circular region. Change this polynomial on the system, and then you have what? And then dx dy is r dc, that dr. The r is g, right? And then r is from 0 to 1 over 2, there's a radius. And then theta goes up 0 to pi. So you integrate, you still get the minus pi over 2. So these are same. Okay. So obviously, the line integral is simple. Okay, we finished this. Okay, in the tutorial, we still have a few examples about this Stokes theorem and Gauss theorem, right? So, this is also going to convenient system, you know, through all the years we don't cover this. But anyway, so, you only use this, you will not use this general so called covenant coordinate system. You only use a circle coordinate system and a cylindrical coordinate system. That's it, right? So if you are if you are interested in this one, you can go through it anyway. So eventually what happens is that after you have this one, you see the divergence, the curve, the gradient can be expressed in different coordinate systems. So this is in the number for divergence of f. This is x, y, z coordinate system you learn, right? And then we can express this one in cylindrical coordinate system, and that's circular coordinate system. You can see that the same divergence, you have a different mathematical expression in different coordinate system, right? So if you need it, you can use it, but anyway, we will not derive this, but for certain and your problem, we need to do this one. So now you can see this again for curve. You see the curve is very complicated. You see for curve, this is the regular rectangular system, already learned, right? But in cylindrical coordinate system, it's given by this form, and then circular coordinate system, it's given by this form, right? It's more complicated. And then, of course, you can have del, see del square. The del square in x, y, z coordinate system, very straightforward. You can have these three terms. And then this is the cylindrical cone system. This is the polar cone system, the spring cone system. You see that different, right? That's the one.
So, I think they have maybe 10 minutes break, and then after that, we'll try to finish the tutorial 6 today, right?